Praise God. Brother Elwell, are you there?
I'm here.
Oh,
good,
we're
to
so
you
happy
guys
to
again.
Have you. Oh, yeah, it's so great to have you. Folks emailed us. They were really excited that we were going to bring you back on again. We got a full house.
Mm-hmm.
Numbers are very high right now. Praise Jesus. Folks are very, very interested in your research. And, you know, I'm sure by now they're also very curious how you perceive, you know, the progress of this, you know, based on your research and the timing of, you know, your analysis of its trajectory, you know, where you think
mm-hmm.
it might be, when you think it might maybe manifest potentially, that kind of stuff. But anyway, I'm just going to go ahead and turn the mic over to you and say, have at it. Praise God.
Okay. Right now, no one knows exactly where Planet X is at. The mainstream scientific community believes it's somewhere south of the ecliptic. That it actually, and its orbital path is actually at an angle to the ecliptic. So it spends most of its orbit actually below the other planets, you know, relative to Earth's north pole. But when it approaches its perihelion in the asteroid belt, it actually comes up through the plane of the ecliptic and is actually, when it comes closest to the sun, it's actually higher in the sky than the other planets. So it's kind of interesting. It is an interesting orbital path. Right now, most scientists think it's coming somewhere from the south, and the general consensus is that I think it's actually coming from the constellation of Taurus. It'll appear in or near the horns of Taurus, or possibly in Orion, or somewhere in between them. It'll probably travel around those constellations as it approaches. It'll probably come through Taurus and then pass over Orion and so forth as it passes through the plane of the ecliptic. Right now, we don't know exactly where it is. We're pretty sure if it is going to be the sign of the Son of Man, the end of the age, that's going to appear suddenly in the heavens as a heavenly sign of Jesus' second coming. Now, exactly what does that mean? It says in Matthew 24:30 that the sign of the Son of Man in the end of the age will precede the second coming of Christ and possibly be even a part of it, because it says in Matthew 24 that there'll be signs in the sun and the moon and the stars, and the planets themselves and the powers of the heavens themselves will be shaken. It says in Matthew 24:29, the powers of the heavens shall be shaken, and the powers of the heavens are literally the planets. So this means literally that the orbits of the planets will be altered in the tribulation of those days, which is near the end of the tribulation. And then right after that, the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the heavens with and Jesus will, he says, the sign of the Son of Man, and the Son of Man himself will come in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And so this happens right before the resurrection event, described in Matthew 24:31, where he sends his angels with the great sound of a trumpet, and the elect are gathered together from the four winds. So somehow, my theory was that the planet itself, it's somehow related to the resurrection event, and it's also related to the great end time battle that will happen at the end of time, at the end of the tribulation. Some people think that the resurrection or the rapture will occur at the beginning, some at the end. Some people are preaching two raptures. I'm actually what is called a seventh trumpet rapture person. I think that actually the appearance of Planet X and the final assault on Earth from heaven and the assault on the forces of Satan will be about the same time. Basically what happens is the believers are resurrected, the heavenly army is formed, and they return back with Jesus to fight against the powers of evil. And Planet X will be an intrinsic part of that. In fact, it's very similar to the kind of the storyline of the original Star Wars movies, in that there's this huge planet-like object coming right towards them, along with a star fleet and the rest of it. The major difference being, In the movie Star Wars, the people with the approaching planet and the fleet and all the rest, those are the bad guys, whereas in the end times, it appears that those will actually be the good guys. Jesus will be leading this sort of heavenly army right behind him. Planet X will be kind of basically being used to wreak havoc on Earth with various asteroids and comets, as described in the trumpet events. Those are basically what sound like asteroids and comets striking the Earth, which are probably emanating from or being as a result of Planet X's near passing. So a lot of what we're seeing with the tribulation is the description of the sort of events that would happen if a large planet passed by Earth. You'd have asteroids and comets, comet-like objects striking Earth, because those are probably going to be its orbital path. And so it makes sense that you'd have giant, heavenly mountains, what are described as burning mountains, and these great other objects that really, really sound a lot like comets and asteroids striking Earth, because that's what will happen. And Jesus himself says he is immediately preceded by this sign in heaven. And so what my theory is that the sign in heaven described in Matthew 24:30 is actually Planet X, which has an orbital period of roughly 2,000 years. And every 2,000 years or so, God has been reappearing and visiting Earth to see how things are coming along. The last time he visited was when Jesus was born, and the Planet X appeared as the Star of Bethlehem. And next time he appears, he'll be returning to conquer and take over the Earth as the conquering king rather than as the suffering servant. And the next time it appears, it'll be appear as the sign of the Son of Man at the end of the age, as described in Matthew 24:30. So the Planet X is, we basically have this large planet, which a long period orbit like that of a long period comet, which roughly 2,000 years or so. And every time it comes back to Earth, in the vicinity of Earth, and it's close past to the sun, God will actually come himself in some form down to Earth to visit Earth and see how things are going. 2,000 years before, 4,000 years before, he appeared to Abraham along with his two servants in a visible form. As when God came to visit Abraham right before he sent his two servants to take out Sodom and Gomorrah, he actually appeared with, spoke to Abraham and visited with Abraham. It was interesting to note then that I think it was the Apocalypse of Abraham or the Testament of Abraham. One of those apocalyptic or apocryphal literatures about Abraham's life, he was actually described as having his birth preceded by a heavenly sign or star as well. And so that was my hint to say, well, this is Planet X having reappeared back then too, roughly 4,000 years ago. Then he appeared around 0 AD as the Star of Bethlehem. And if he reappears in our time, once again, roughly 2,000 years later, the sign of the Son of Man is probably a description of yet another appearance of Planet X. So we have this cyclical pattern of God returning every 2,000 years or so, preceded by this star in heaven. And when major events are about to happen, for example, the birth of Abraham in his life, which was a major event, the birth of Jesus 2,000 years later, Jesus' return an additional 2,000 years later, as a sign of the Son of Man. So its exact position is unknown. I personally think, however, it is approaching. But it won't be visible from Earth until it passes the orbit of Jupiter, because like comets, which are mostly very dark asteroids, which have some water on their surfaces, which gives them their comet tail, most of these asteroids and the comets are actually covered with this thick tar-like organic goo, which makes them pretty much invisible to optical telescopes until they come close enough to the sun for sublimation to occur in their comet tail to form, at which time and only at that time do they become visible by optical telescopes and human eyes. I suspect that Planet X is much similar in the sense that it also has a large preponderance of dust and dark clouds surrounding it. So that it's actually invisible to the naked eye until it comes close to the sun, at which time it actually forms a comet-like tail. In this case, it looks more like a pair of wings, because in the Sumerian images of this planet, it actually appears to be kind of like it has wings instead of a tail, which is probably just the way, because it's such a large object, it probably has a lot more water, and the fluid dynamics of it is a little bit different, but it's essentially an appearance of a gigantic comet, and it won't appear again visible to Earth until it passes Jupiter, at which time the solar winds are powerful enough to start the comet tail to start forming. And that comet tail will then make it visible from Earth suddenly and gloriously, just like Jesus describes, he will reappear like a thief in the night. This is what it's returning. This is what he's talking about. Planet X will suddenly and gloriously become visible within maybe a matter of day, weeks or even days, as this comet tail suddenly begins to form, people on Earth will begin to see it and realize exactly what's happening, what's been hidden from this entire time, and what's about to happen. And that's what it says in Revelation, I think it's Revelation 6, I'll look it up. Men are hiding themselves under the rocks to hide against the throne of the Lamb, because they can suddenly see this thing in heaven, and it's approaching Earth. And this happens about midway through tribulation, I believe, actually, right after all the then-believing Christians on Earth are Christianity, organized Christianity, is destroyed, and most Christians are executed. Because of this, they then see that God's vengeance is coming in heaven, and they're about to get really whopped because Planet X is about to attack within the next couple of years. And so, whereas I cannot give you a time as to when Planet X will occur now, will appear, I can say once the tribulation starts, it will most likely become visible about halfway through the tribulation, about 3.5 years in, 3.5 to 4 years in. And it'll become visible by the naked eye. And then it'll appear at its closest point to the sun, probably about 6 or 7 years into the tribulation, at which time it'll come close enough to Earth to actually cause, you know, significant disasters. And that's when you have not only the trumpet judgments, but also the bowl judgments, which are the most powerful effects of Planet X as it passes closest to Earth. And then right after Planet X does its damage, then Jesus' heavenly army will attack and wipe out everything that's left over, which won't be much, because Planet X's attack will be pretty dramatic and pretty destructive, as it's described in the book of Revelation. We see these bowl judgments where, you know, all life in the seas is destroyed, and all the green grass and all the trees are destroyed. I mean, there's not much left, and the major cities are being destroyed. All that's going to be left is basically these underground bunkers, and a lot of them are going to be taken out. The reference to Planet X actually appearing in the heavens, I think the first time mankind actually sees it. And it says that in Revelation 6. Where the kings of the earth and the great man and the rich men, the chief captains and the mighty men, and every bondman and every free man hid themselves in the dens on the rock of the mountains, and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? I think they're actually seeing Planet X beginning to appear, and this actually happens right after the sixth seal, basically what sounds like a massive meteor shower. It says in Revelation 6:13, and the stars of heaven fell into the earth, even as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs, when she is shaken of a mighty wind. And the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island removed out of their places. What this means is that the meteor shower, like the long day of Joshua, there were so many heavy meteors hitting Earth, probably at an angle contrary to its rotation rate, that Earth's rotation is actually altered, probably because the crust is temporarily displaced from the mantle, and it becomes, you know, independent of the mantle temporarily, slowing down or possibly reversing. And in this way, as from our current reckoning, every mountain and island is actually moving its place, because the entire crust is being displaced above the mantle by these massive, huge asteroids that are hitting the Earth, causing massive destruction to Earth's cities. These are much more powerful than nuclear weapons. Even though they're not radioactive, they're sending out gigantic clouds of dust into the atmosphere, which will result in a nuclear winter. And for years to come, the summer's going to be colder and shorter, and the winter's going to be long and very cold. So God is basically breaking down the civilization that mankind had built in opposition to him by battering with asteroid after asteroid after asteroid, to the point where when he actually does return at the head of his heavenly army, comprised of the believers who were resurrected, then he'll be more of a mop-up action rather than an actual battle. And they'll be focusing on taking out the last strong military force, which will apparently be assembling itself in the Vale of Megiddo, and I think it's south of Palestine area. But yeah, that's kind of the general idea behind the Planet X theory, is that it's It's a planet that's been hidden from mankind in purpose, but it's been one of God's primary secrets. In fact, in my opinion, it is actually the great secret of the Book of Revelation. When I was writing the book, I've been studying Annihilation, some other parallel texts that were similar to, but not the same as, the biblical texts regarding the resurrection, or regarding the creation, I mean. And a number of theologians had noted similarities between the Babylonian creation epic and also biblical texts. Some had theorized that the Bible had simply been ripped off from them, but others think that they were just parallel traditions drawing on the same root source material, which is my... And I noted that the description of the Babylonian god Marduk, which is Planet X in the Sitchinite theory, very similar. When I was reading Revelation 4, I recognized the description of Jesus on his throne was similar in kind of scope and concept to that of the description of Marduk on his throne, almost to the point where it seemed that Jesus was actually saying, Marduk is a false god, I am the one true God, and it's, I am the king of this heavenly throne. And I realized, you know, what if he was actually talking about Planet X? Because it seemed to be kind of the idea behind the end times. If Planet X did exist, it would be a huge deal. And it would be a great secret, a very great secret that had been hidden very, very carefully from mankind for a long time. And if it did exist and it came close to Earth, it would have massive destructive effects. What if it was actually not just a part of the Book of Revelation, but was actually the central secret of the Book of Revelation, which will be revealed in the end times? And so I looked at Revelation 4, I realized, you know, this is a description not of some big square throne that, you know, the God is sitting in heaven, that Jesus is sitting on. This is actually a description of Planet X itself. The heavenly throne is symbolically his Planet X is symbolically his heavenly throne. And I thought about that, and I was looking at the description of the throne, and he says it was like a jasper and a sardine stone. This is Revelation 4, 3. And there was a rainbow around it, like an emerald. I realized, you know, he's basically saying sardine stone is basically a red stone. And he's saying this throne in heaven was a stone in heaven, literally a stone in heaven that was red. And I'm just taking this jewelry. This thing is saying that there was a red stone in heaven with a rainbow around it, which I think might actually be a description of what a Saturn-like ring system. And which would Planet X would probably have too, because if there was a lot of shadow material in orbit around it, it would form a ring. So that would make sense. And it also says around the throne were 24 and 20 seats, and, you know, 24 seats, 24 elders, and seven lamps of fire burning before the throne, and also four beasts around it. I remembered in the description of the appearance of Marduk in Annihilation that he was surrounded by two sets of winds, what he was called, like these objects that he used as weapons. And I remember in the Hebrew, the word for spirit, ruach, actually basically means wind. So the concept of these spirits around the throne could be translated as winds around the throne too. And I thought of that, you know, maybe there is a group of, since there's a group of four winds around Marduk's throne and a group of seven winds also, two separate groups. And there's also two separate groups of spirits or winds around the throne of Jesus, a group of four creatures, as they're called, and a group of seven flaming lamps. Maybe they're actually talking about satellites surrounding Planet X. Moreover, on another show, I was asked, you know, why do the four creatures, why are they described as having being full of eyes before and behind in Revelation 4, 6? You know, it says they're basically covered with eyes. And It basically, the Hebrew word for eye is ayin, which basically means nothing. It's like saying not or ought. And the concept, the application of the word ayin means when you're referring to a person, ayin refers to the eye socket or the eye in general. And when referring to a planet or an object of any kind, it's like it has a hole in it. And so if you're talking about these four objects around the throne of God, if this was indeed a planetary concept and these were actually satellites, it would make sense because In that context, it would not be translated as eyes. It would be translated as craters. Just like our moon is covered with craters, so too these moons around planet X are covered with craters. So that makes sense. And so that's kind of where I'm at now. Basically, what we have is a situation where planet X is going to be returning. We're going to see this thing again. It's going to be the most incredible sight. And like you guys were talking about before, this whole buildup and all these terrorist actions, we're being herded towards a one-world unified system, which could be used to oppose the second coming of Christ and all of his forces. So it'll be basically not only the forces of Jesus and the force versus the force of Satan, it'll also be one planet versus another planet. Planet X versus Earth, Jesus versus Satan. It's Jesus' throne versus Satan's throne. You see how that works. And so it makes sense at this point, in this context, that this would actually not just be a heavenly sign like a star or a supernova conjunction of planets. It is actually a planet returning from, you know, the end of heaven after a long journey, returning with weapons of war, as Isaiah describes it, to destroy the whole earth. This is what he's talking about. This is a planet returning, on which Jesus or the Father will be using, Jesus will be using as one of his main weapons to destroy the dragon and his armies. And so that's kind of where I'm at now. And but there hasn't been any additional Planet X information coming out recently. Most of the Planet X information of significance came out in the 80s and 90s because of the Voyager probes, and when they flew past the outer planets, they realized there must be kind of a Planet X object out there, because that's the only way that we can explain these anomalies in the outer planets that the Voyager probes found. But since that time, we haven't had any significant stuff because we haven't had the probes out there that have found anything. So right now, all we do is speculate.
Right, right. What I think is two things. Well, one thing in particular. First of all, Lowell, according to the encyclopedias, and I'll quote this to you. I don't know what the citation. Actually, there are several citations to this paragraph. It says, Percival Lowell's greatest contribution to planetary studies came during the last decade of his life, which he devoted to the search for Planet X, a hypothetical planet beyond Neptune. Lowell believed that the planets Uranus and Neptune were displaced from their predicted positions by the gravity of the unseen planet. Lowell started his search program in 1906 using a camera of 5 inches. In aperture. The small field of view, 42-inch, 110-centimeter reflecting telescope, rendered the instruments impractical for searching. From 1914 to 1916, a 9-inch, 23-centimeter telescope was on loan from the Sproul Observatory, which was used to search for Planet X. Although Lowell did not discover Pluto, Lowell's observatory did photograph Pluto in March and April of 1915. And it goes on to explain that the reason why Lowell ultimately even heard about or even speculated that Planet X existed originally was because of his study of gods, little g gods, of Japan. And, you know, the Far East and such. And I noticed in your book, you know, you had tied in some of the ancient Near Eastern religion planetary deities. And I wondered if maybe that was some of the stuff that triggered Lowell into thinking, hey, this might be the real deal, and kind of, you know, thrust his research forward. I don't know. What do you think?
Well, the astronomers had always been motivated by the search for extraterrestrial life and try to understand our history, too. And I do think that part of the motivation was to see, since there were 12 gods, maybe there were 12 objects in our solar system to account for the gods. Because in every tradition since the Sumerians and probably before that, consistently every major empire passed down from one to the other the belief that all the planets were gods, or the thrones of gods, to be more specifically, and they were to be worshipped as gods. And so from Sumer, Akkad, Babylon, Assyria, Persia, Greece, and all the way to Rome, where we have our current planet names, Mars, Jupiter, Venus, these are all Roman deity names. They felt that they wanted to justify, prove or deny, was the fact that these named after gods, did it have any significance? Was there, in fact, deities associated with these planets, and were there enough planets to be account for all these gods. And the pantheon of 12, it was always 12. Even since the Sumerians, 12 was the magic number. The Romans even followed this pattern. If you're missing a god, another one was put in his place to make sure he always had 12. And so Zechariah Sitchin picked up on this fact. He had his own twist on it, which I don't necessarily agree with. But I do believe his theory that the Sumerians were actually talking about literal planets moving through our solar system and causing chaos. I do believe he was correct, because not because I wanted to, because it lines up with the facts. Now, this is not some Velikovsky in garbage, and Velikovsky was terrible. I can't even read him. Even when I was a kid, I read Velikovsky and I realized, this is garbage. It didn't make any sense. How can Venus emerge out of Jupiter and be in its current orbit? It would have a hugely elliptical orbit if it had come outside of Jupiter. It has to have formed in its original orbital path in order to have such a perfectly circular orbit, which is another point I make in that book. Or at least maybe, I don't know if I made it in the book, if I've made it since then. Why do the orbital characteristics of Mercury and Venus, why are they perfectly the way they should be according to normal nebular hypothesis, where planets form out of the nebular disk and they're either prograde or retrograde orbits, that is to say backwards, they rotate either backwards and forwards. Their orbits will be stable and circular. They wouldn't have any significant moons or circular satellite systems, no axial tilts, no large impacts, no oceans. They'd be very boring, basically, and they'd be basically the same way they were when they formed, according to the nebular hypothesis, when they formed out of the nebular disk. They're basically the same as they would have done according to the scientific models, which show that Mercury and Venus are pretty much the way they should be. But when you go to Earth on outwards, every single planet is an oddball. It doesn't match up with the standard accretional hypothesis. It shouldn't be this way. Earth should not have this 23.5-degree axial tilt. It should not have such a gigantic moon. It's the only planet in the solar system that has an ocean, which must have been caused by one or more giant impactors, because the Earth's ocean is believed is actually formed out of impact events which forced water out of the mantle, because most of the mantle is actually comprised, most of the water on Earth is actually in the mantle, in water-bearing, what are called hydrous minerals, like serpentine and talc, which are partly made of water. And when they're subject to compression by violent force, such as an asteroid impact, they release the water chemically. The chemical bonds are broken and the water is released. So my theory is that is the same impact that created the moon also created the oceans and thereby the atmosphere as we have today, because otherwise we would have enough, carbon dioxide and water and related elements to support life, to have the kind of atmosphere we have, the hydrosphere we have with all the water and the rain and so forth, and the clouds. All these events were created by one gigantic impact, and they could only have been created by one gigantic impact. Earth's axial tilt, its rapid rotation rate, once every 24 hours. Venus rotates maybe 3 to 5 times as much, three to four times per year on its axis. When we rotate 365 times per year, why are we so much faster than Venus or Mercury is also very slow. But Earth on outwards, they're very rapid rotations, as if energy had been added to the rotation by some external object adding energy into the system. So the only way, in my opinion, to explain these anomalies is to say there has to be an external force coming in, adding energy into the planets, by which manifests itself in the form of causing them to spin faster, causing them to have rotational, to axial tilts, whereas they should not have had axial tilts. As they formed out of the nebular cloud, they should be perfectly perpendicular to the nebular, the line of the ecliptic. They're not. None of them are. Even Jupiter has a slight angle to its axial tilt. There shouldn't be any significant moons. There's no reason to have any, unless there's an actor that coming outside the system to penetrate it and cause the creation of a moon, because Earth's moon was, it's now universally agreed, was caused by the was created by a giant impactor striking Earth at a rapid rate, an impactor which was roughly the size of Mars, not Mars itself, but about that size and mass, striking Earth, jettisoning out a large amount of its mantle, which cooled and solidified into orbit around the Earth to form the Moon. That has been proven mathematically and chemically that it has to have happened that way. So how do these other moons form? You know, dozens of moons on all these other planets, how are they forming? There must have been an actor coming in our solar system, disrupting them, dropping off moons as it passes through, and by Jupiter and Saturn have dozens of moons. They shouldn't have formed that way. It doesn't make any sense. The ring systems, why are they there? Why does, I guess, Uranus have a ring system which apparently formed after it was tilted outside? Totally bizarre. There's so many really extreme anomalies. It's just people who are aware of how things work and understand how physics work and science and astronomy realize that the only way that these things could have happened is if a massive object, roughly 3 to 5 times the mass of Earth, possibly 7 times, like one man has theorized recently, that's reasonable, would pass close enough to them at a rapid rate to cause, you know, gravitational interactions, which would cause them to, for example, the planet Neptune to be tilted at a significant angle. Planet Uranus tilted so dramatically that it's almost, its south polar axis is currently almost pointed directly at the sun. And that's an extreme difference from what it should be. It's like 70-something, 65, 70% off where it should be if it were perpendicular to the angle of the ecliptic. It's way, way off. And so basically right now, the north pole on the north rotational pole on Uranus is in total darkness and will be for hundreds of years. But its south pole is receiving direct sunlight or near to it. And it'll have direct sunlight for centuries more. It doesn't make any sense. It can only have happened if a massive object passed into our solar system from the outside at an angle, you know, an approach which is more or less perpendicular to the orbits of the planets, and interacted with them occasionally once every few thousand years, imparted some of its energy into the systems and caused these axial tilts to causes these moons to form through, catastrophic collisions. This is not me talking. This is actual the scientists who studied the Voyager data. This is the conclusion they came to. It isn't wacko conspiracy theorists on the internet or Zachariah Sitchin or whoever. This is the best people in the world, best astronomers, best physicists, best people ever, top men. They said Planet X must have caused this, not me, not Sitchin, not anybody else. And that's why I'm so confident in this hypothesis, because it's backed up by real scientific data. The scientists are saying this, and they've been propagating this knowledge for decades. Just nobody is listening. It requires people to, you have to keep pushing. You have to say, coming back at it again and again and again, Planet X is out there, Planet X is out there, Planet X is out there. It has to be out there. The science proves it. Why don't you accept it? Why would you not accept it? That's what bothers me. Is people, they don't think about science. They don't care about facts. They're like, what do I want? What do I don't want? And they base their decision making based on their own personal opinions and what they want to see, rather than what the facts state. You can leave the Bible out of it. You can leave Sitchin out of it. Just boil it down to the facts. Planet X has to exist, and it has to fit the criteria that Sitchin suggested, that it's going to enter into our solar system occasionally and become visible. The historical data backs this up. Abraham was preceded by a star that came out of nowhere. The Magi followed a star that came out of nowhere. The second coming of Christ, another star comes out of nowhere. Roughly 2,000 year gap between each of those. Why is it so hard to understand? I don't get it. Very easy to understand, very simple, backed by facts. Everyone agrees with it. All the traditions agree with it. The science is there. The religion is there. All you have to do is be open-minded enough to accept it. And that is the toughest thing to do, because if you have all the facts, if people don't want to accept it, they will not accept it, and there's nothing you can do to change that.
Yeah, amen. I mean, I did some research on, you know, yellow dwarf stars in the Milky Way galaxy, and supposedly, I wish I had the article handy here right at this moment. I don't have another one though, but evidently, it's well known by astrophysicists that yellow dwarf stars, which is what we have, in the Milky Way galaxy, the predominant the vast majority of them are binary. That it's extremely common for yellow dwarf stars in this galaxy to be binary star systems. So, just de facto, you know, default common sense would indicate that we probably would be binary as the other ones or the majority of the other ones are. Here's another thing that's interesting. I think April 25th of 2011. Published on Cornell University site is a paper by Lorenzo Lorio, who's an Italian physicist, I guess. And he it says, and the title of the paper is On the Anomalous Secular Increase of the Eccentricity of the Orbit of the Moon. What's fascinating is there was a movie, because I personally believe, and I know that it's anecdotal in a sense, but there's when you understand this, you know, when you're a big believer in spirituality, you understand the concepts of lesser magic, you understand how the devil works, and how things work, you know, over the years, and actually going back thousands of years, it makes sense. But anyway, in this paper, he wrote this scientific paper. He basically goes in and it's all very scientifically, you know, written and says, you know, I'll give a little snippet here. It says basically, a recent analysis of the lunar laser ranging LLR data spanning 38.7 years revealed an anomalous increase to the eccentricity of E of the lunar orbit amounting to E means equals 9 plus or minus 3 times 10 to the minus 12 over the year cycle. The present day models of dissipative phenomena occurring in the interiors of both the Earth and the Moon are not able to explain it. And then he goes down, I'm going to skip ahead, he says, a potential viable Newtonian candidate would be a trans-Plutonian massive object such as Planet X Nemesis Tyche. He actually quotes those in his paper. This paper was vetted by the scientific community and published in the library at Cornell University, and to the best of my understanding, is still there even today. This goes all the way back to April of 2011, which is fascinating. And then another thing I'd like to get you to comment on, because I just think this is so cool, and I know that it's very popular to debunk things. I get that. I get that people who are science-minded, I guess they have a feeling or whatever that if they debunk things that, you know, maybe that adds credibility to their story. I don't know. I've seen it happen time and time again. But, you know, I've been studying this stuff for a long, 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 long time. And I think it's fascinating that in the movie Deep Impact, which, of course, by the way, coincidentally has a black president, which has been brought up a thousand times. In that movie, you've got this this concept of a meteor ultimately heading toward the Earth. Okay, so most everybody gets that whole premise. Now, what's fascinating, however, other than the the correlation of the events and the similarities between that presidency and the things that are going on in the Earth today, there's one thing in that movie that just absolutely knocked me off my chair. When I watched it, I was like, no way. There's a scene, actually multiple scenes, in the movie Deep Impact, where at this point, this comet, quote, is getting close enough to the Earth where it's an imminent threat. Okay, and they pan the camera back, and they put as the little I don't know what you're gonna subheading underneath the image. They have the White House. The sun is shining above the White House, and off to the left in the sky, to the left of the sun, is what appears to be a second sun. But in fact, it's the comet that has gotten to the point where, you know, it is reflecting somehow the light of the sun in such a way that during even a daylight hour, you know, in this movie, you're seeing the sun, and then off to the left, what appears to be a second sun. And in the movie, though, it's actually supposed to be the comet. And it would say 2 weeks until impact, 3 weeks until impact, 1 week until impact. And there's this second sun dynamic, you know, a sun and a second sun. And if you go out onto YouTube, now I've been researching the second sun phenomenon for years, and it's real. You know, I've had very scientific Christian people on the radio show before, and they just debunk it. You know, that's their thing. They like to debunk. Okay, fine, that's your gig. If you want to debunk, you be the great debunker. I wasn't born in a barn. Last time I checked, I actually have a birth certificate, and I got a scientific background myself. And it's electronics engineering. And I've been researching these things and studying these photographs. I know what a camera lens flare is. I get it. Okay, and there, all you have to do is type second sun on Google and look at, not all the pictures are necessarily legit, but just look at the body of information that's out there. It's unbelievable. And what's fascinating is the second sun pictures, many of them are surprisingly similar to the image that they had in the movie Deep Impact. And I'm wondering, do you think it's possible, and it's okay if you think it's some other anomaly, who cares, but do you think it's possible that there's some kind of a relationship? Because, you know, back in 2001, there weren't no second suns. Back into, you know, I was around. I have YouTube. I've been doing computers since 1983. I built an XT, an 8 megahertz XT on a carpet with a 40 watt lamp, doing a low level format in 1985. I've been around. I get it. Okay, and I've studied this stuff, and back in 2003, 2004, 2005, there were no second suns. But then 2008, 2009, Shazam, they're all over the place. They're all over the place. And I'm like, what do you think? You know, just without going into the automatic, hey, I'm a scientist kind of a guy and I'm going to debunk it, because debunking is easy. Any NASA monkey can debunk. Okay, what are the second suns? What do you think they are? Is it related to, maybe in some way, to this phenomenon?
You know, I have no idea. I suppose it could be part of it. Maybe there are large comets passing near the sun they don't want us to know about, or they're trying to, you know, not to scare us. There might be stuff coming in that's dangerous to us they don't want us to see. Maybe there's a lens flare. Maybe this Planet X. I really don't know. I haven't seen them, so I couldn't say. Problem is, there are a lot of lens flare phenomena going on. It's difficult to see.
Yes.
Or is it sun dog or something else? What's the sun dog and which one's Planet X? I don't have the equipment to tell the difference. And since I'm of the opinion that Planet X won't become visible from Earth until midway through the tribulation, I tend to ignore it because it doesn't fit into my worldview. I'm not saying I couldn't be wrong, but if it's there, it's interesting. But I think the way Jesus operates, it says the Lord will come suddenly to his temple. He doesn't kind of come bits and pieces. Just like it says in, you know, Matthew 24, when they say, look out, he's in the desert, or is he in the hidden place? No, he says, how does it go here? If any man say to you, lo, here is Christ, there, believe it or not.
Yep.
Behold, he is in a desert. Behold, he is in a secret chamber. For as the lightning comes out of the east and shines to the west, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. It's a big, obvious thing. Planet X is not going to be showing up in lens flare-like photos, this and that. It's going to be a big deal. It's going to be an in-your-face situation. This is the preliminary to a major, major battle. And so they're going to make it so it has maximum psychological impact. And that means not flirting around the edges of the sun. It's going to appear suddenly and gloriously.
Okay, I agree. So let me ask you this. I mean, because suddenly and gloriously is like, okay, Shazam, pow, pow, everybody goes, whoa! But could there be, you know, I like your possibility that you tossed out there, that these may be artifacts that are associated with other possibly debris or related objects. associated with it, because I think that is highly plausible. And other people support that, by the way. The other thing I was wondering is, let me just think here. Oh, yeah. Do you perceive how do you see the Kuiper Belt being, what's that a result of? Do you think that, and this is also linked back to the Professor Harrington thing. As you know, Harrington bought off on the whole deal that Planet X was ultimately a planetary object of some type that had, as they stated, 5 to 7 moons, rotating around it. Now, of course, there are other theories that suggest that instead of that being a planet with moons, in fact, it was a little bit bigger than that. It was actually truly a binary star that failed, and instead of moons, they were actually 5 to 7 planets that were moving around it, and that we are dealing with another solar system with a failed star moving into our solar system. And of course, if you do some research on the whole brown dwarf deal, you also discover that a brown dwarf, when it gets just like a comet, a brown dwarf, when it gets in the right proximity and heading away from the sun, it ionizes. It forms, ultimately a type of a tail, red iron oxide dust, which could be accounted for turning the oceans, red like blood, like it says in the Trumpet Judgments. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. I just throw that out there. But how do you feel about the Professor Harrington embracing the 5 to 7 moon theory thing
around Planet X?
Yeah.
I'm not sure. You had a question about the Kuiper Belt. The Kuiper Belt's still a theoretical belt. We haven't proven it. But it's based on the theory that the comets originate from a belt from outside of our solar system, which is occasionally perturbed by objects which throw comets into our solar system. And that explains why they have long periods which take them in and out of the solar system, because when they go back out, they're returning to their point of origin. My theory is that the point of origin of all comets was not the outer solar system. It was actually Earth itself as a result of the giant impact. When the giant impactor hit the Earth, it threw up a great deal of water into the atmosphere and actually into space. In fact, the asteroid belt, only a year or two ago, we found out there's a huge amount of water ice on the asteroid, which should not have happened according to, the hypothesis of how things are supposed to form. Water does not form that way. This can only happen as a result of an existing body of water being basically thrown into space. So that was kind of a proof that the Planet X giant impact theory that I put forward in my book, Planet X, the Sign of the Son of Man and the End of the Age. And also I put forward there that the comets were actually formed from a lot of the water that was thrown up by the giant impactor, which also formed our seas and atmosphere. And also, as a result, there are a lot of the asteroids had a lot of water ice on them. And when Planet X passed on its way out of our solar system, it dragged some of them along with it. As it passed some of these outer planets, they added gravitational interactions, which stripped away the comets and gave them independent orbits. And so that all comets and all asteroids, the great majority of them, originated from Earth, being struck by a giant impactor. And then the activity of Planet X moving in and out of our solar system and a long elliptical orbit created these long period comets and asteroids, because they're probably long period asteroids that we can't see because they're dark. So I do think the Kuiper Belt theory is based on false premises that the comets did in fact form outside of our solar system. I do believe they formed from the mantle of Earth as a result of the giant impact. And one major proof to my theory is, which her harms the theory, is there was recently a probe called the Stardust Probe that took samples from the comet of Vilsa 2 a few years ago. And they wanted to see, their assumption, which was incorrect, that the comet had come from the outer solar system. So they assumed incorrectly that the dust in the comet's tail would be comprised of elements from the outside of our solar system, and there why we could determine the chemical composition isotopic ratios, that's the thing of the elements outside of our solar system and its theoretical hyperbelt, which has never been proven. But when they actually got this material back, which they had this super sophisticated aerogel, which they used to collect dust in the comet's tail, they then, when they got this material back, they found that the chemical composition was not that of our solar system. It was actually identical to that object that had formed in the inner solar system. So this comet had actually formed in the inner solar system, proving the Chaplin-Dextein-Tympeck theory that comets originated not from outside the solar system, but from within the inner solar system, most likely from Earth, the only significant water-bearing planet.
Wow. Okay, so you definitely don't agree with the whole theory that there was another planet in this solar system that had come into some kind of great impact and busted into a whole bunch of little pieces.
No, the original impact of what struck Earth was actually still embedded to Earth to this day. In fact, if you look at plottings of Earth's core, it's actually slightly off center. This might be related to the Sheol buried into Earth referenced in the Bible. It might have to do with this impact here, impactor, which is buried into the Earth itself. When it says in Job, Sheol was laid bare, and my interpretation of the Planet X interpretation, my interpretation of that when Job was talking about the Sheol being laid bare in the context of creation events and a conflict, was that actually this is referring to Earth's mantle being opened up as a result of this giant impact, and the inner Earth, or Sheol, was revealed to the surface. You could actually see it because there was a huge hole that led all the way down to the mantle temporarily. This impactor remains on Earth's core to this day. But this impactor was a satellite, a former satellite of Planet X, which embedded itself inside of Earth. But Planet X itself remains intact. And so the original, the source of the impactor of Planet X remains intact, but the impactor itself is inside Planet Earth as we speak. And remnants of Earth can be seen floating in the asteroid belt and also in the comets and various asteroid groups like the Mars, Apollos, and Autons, and the inner solar system. It could only be explained by that kind of activity. I do hold that Planet X is actually a rocky body or possibly a heavy, like an ice and rock. I don't think it's a large gas planet. Nor do I think it is a brown dwarf. I think it is actually a pretty good-sized planet, somewhere in size between, let's say, maybe about 3 to 5 times the size of Earth, maybe a little larger or smaller, I don't know. Rocky or mostly or completely rocky, and surrounded by a series of substantially large satellites, similar in size to our moon. But it's actually a total of 11 large satellites. It may comprise of a group of 7, a group of 4, and a group of smaller satellites, 24 in number, corresponding with the 24 elders. And it also has a ring system, a gigantic tail, which forms when it comes, or actually wings that forms when it comes close to the sun, and some other interesting features, which I talk about in my book.
Wow. So, and one of the things you mentioned in the book was, the man in the moon concept with Job, and then the companions mm-hmm. / the comments, and then also the echoes of the divine mm-hmm. conflict with Job. Can you connect a couple of the Job dots for us? Because Job is just loaded with all kinds of mysteries.
Job is constantly talking about Leviathan and the battle between God and Rahab. Rahab and Leviathan Rahab's mentioned a couple of times. It's not always translated into the English text, but it occurs at least 2 or 3 times in the context of a creation, specifically creation battle. My basic theory that Job is actually the Hebrew equivalent of Babylonian creation epic, working on the same oral traditions that the Enuma Elish, the Babylonian creation epic, drew from, but it was interpreted differently and formatted differently in the sense that it was actually a play, that was an opera that was sung. In fact, at the beginning of the book of Job, it says, God sung and said, and then Satan sung and said. You know, when Satan appeared before him along with the other sons of God, they were actually singing to each other. So this is actually an opera, which is like the Greek plays or poems. They were sung so they could be more easily remembered because there's a melody going along with these things. And it's much easier to remember the information if it's part of a song or like a play, because it has, you know, it has a logical order which can be reconstructed, and there's musical notes which will help remind you of certain words. The music itself might have special meanings that it's intended to achieve, like, you know, if you have a sudden, like, dramatic bass sound, it might mean something bad is about to happen. Whereas a high treble sound might mean, you know, God is, you know, something bringing his grace. There's a lot of stuff we've lost because we've lost the original information. The Psalms, we've lost the music for that too. I suspect it's probably hidden inside the Hebrew itself in a really clever way. So one of my many, many long list of projects is to try to figure out, do the Psalms have the notes, the musical notes hidden in them themselves, somehow in the Hebrew? In fact, the Hebrew might be interpreted as notes itself. Do the letters of Hebrew actually have sounds and so forth? So, Job is basically, it's an opera. It was a constructed tale based on real events in a real person's life. Job was a man, a Hebrew, who was the richest man in the land of Sumer. He lived near the capital city of Ur, which would be Ur III, probably in existence, I think, around 2500 to 2000 BC, something like that. And the events of, I believe, that are timed by the beginning of the both Enumelish and the book of Job. In the beginning of Enumelish, we have not one but two appearances of the gods in the heavens. Also in the book of Job, you have two appearances of these divine beings, not once but twice. With these appearances, the sons of God got together, they gathered before God, along, and Satan was among them. This is actually a description of the planets in heaven. The sons of God, in a sense, are described as a metaphor used for the planets, because they cannot use the names of the planets because they are deity names, and you can't use that in the Bible, so they use the generic term sons of God. And the fact that they appeared twice was interesting, because I had noted around 2000 BC to 1900 BC, that area, there were two massings of all of the planets in one quadrant of the sky. I think it was around... The first one was like 1970 BC, and the other one's around 1916, 1914 BC, something like that. And as a result, because of this mass, these massings of the planets are unique in history, in human history. It's only happened once like this. You can actually use these massings, this position of these planets in one quadrant of the sky, to time the book of Job and also Enumelish, the writing of Enumelish. Because since it was referencing the gods in the sky as having a kind of a congregation. The gods are having a congregation when they were talking to each other in the Babylonian creation epic. And the sons of God appear in assembly before God, you know, also in the sky. I do believe that was a metaphor for a collection of planets in the sky, which was unusual. And therefore, the actual events of the book of Job, the near flyby of Planet X, happened sometime between 1900 and 2000 BC. Based on that timing principle, probably sometime between 1950 and 1920 BC. And I don't want to off my original point, but yeah, sorry, Book of Job. So the Book of Job is basically a recitation of a reappearance of Planet X around 1900 to 2000 BC. And at that time, they decided to write down all the information, the oral traditions and so forth they had in circulation at that time, and write them down into a comprehensive format. The Babylonians created the Enumelish around that time, and the Hebrews created Job around that time. Both different peoples taking their own oral traditions, and there was some crossover because Rahab and Leviathan are actually mentioned. Actually, Tiamat's not mentioned, so it wasn't a crossover statement. The idea of actual dragons being involved with this mention. Rahab and her helpers are mentioned, and Job, Leviathan is mentioned a couple of times. At least once, the major passage of Leviathan describing him as being this great dragon-like creature. I actually think that chapter is actually a description of God's combat with the dragon. And when he's talking about breathing out fire out of his nose or of his mouth, it's actually a reference to God breathing out fire, not the dragon, in his battle against the dragon. But I didn't have enough time and space to put that in the book, so I left it up for a future revised and expanded version if there was interest. But Basically, I determined based on my analysis of the Malish and Job, and others had done this before, other academic scholars had done this over 100 years ago, the primary among them being a man, I think his name was Sigmund Mowinckel, and there were others too, John Day and some other prominent academic authors in more recent times. John Day's classic, God's Conflict with the Dragon in the Sea, that was highly influential on me too, and he basically went through how there was clear parallels between the book of various passages of the, including Job, a lot of stuff in Job. In fact, by far the most creation material related, specifically related to the name Elish, is to be found in Job. And I realized, based on that, that they were correct, and not only were they correct, they were underestimating the total material involved. As I dug deeper and deeper, I realized that the creation battle between God and the dragon was the core concept behind this entire thing. In fact, this was the Hebrew version of the Babylonian creation epic. The only real difference between it was is the way the information was presented. The Babylonian creation epic, they presented in the form of a drama with the names of deities who were associated with the planets. And these deities had this dramatic interactions, and there was conflicts and combats between the gods and so forth. Much simpler format, actually, to understand than the more erudite but much more complicated, more literary operatic format followed by, and they were both operas. Both the Babylonian and Israelite versions were both sung as part of their, probably as their New Year's festival. Both of them were probably sung at their respective New Year's festivals. And the Hebrew version, which, of course, you know, was paralleled the Babylonian tradition, it was in the form of like an intellectual discussion between Job, his friends, and finally God, saying, why is this happening to me? Why was I, you know, I cursed the day I was born, why did the dragon fight against God, that sort of thing. And it was strangely interrelated with these references to the dragon and its creation battle. And it doesn't make sense unless you realize in its context, this is a book of its time. This is a book written in the context of ancient times, in the context of the Malish. It fits in perfectly with the dominant ancient Near Eastern thought pattern at that time, where the creation of the earth was Earth's thought of being the head of a dragon, which had been cut off by a divine being that appeared in heaven as a gigantic flaming bright star. It struck Earth with one or more of its weapons, divided it into two pieces, one became heaven, one became earth. And that is the current situation. We're in the situation right now, where we're literally living on the head of this dragon, which had been cut off from the rest of its body, that its tail had been twisted into a great circle of stone in heaven, Akkadian ruckus, which corresponds not only conceptually, but also, it's also cognate to the Hebrew word rakia, which is the word we use for firmament. So when you see the word firmament, which was incorrectly translated as these, like these hardened bronze plates that formed this shell of a universe in which we live in, like in this great sphere. What it actually says, the word rakia means something that is struck and beaten into small pieces and spread out, just like the asteroids were struck from a larger body and broken into small pieces and spread out in a circle in heaven, which is exactly what the Akkadian term rakus means. Rakus and rakia are cognate, they mean the same thing. Somehow, something being bashed into small pieces and spread out is translated into like these bronze flattened out plates, which makes no sense. They're clearly talking about the asteroid belt there. So the dragon's tail is thought of this great circle of stones floating in heaven, which was one of the heavens, I believe it was the second heaven, two of the three heavens. And the earth was basically the majority of the dragon, really symbolically its head. And we were planted on earth in order to make sure that the dragon would never rise again. Our purpose on earth is to make sure the powers of evil are kept down and not allowed to rise again until the time of the end. And this goes into my larger theory that mankind was planted on earth along with animals and plants to be fruitful and multiply to make sure that the power of the dragon was not allowed to rise again, that spiritual power. So when we spread across the earth, we had kind of this blanket of biomass that keeps the demons from rising again somehow. It's an interesting concept. I'll get into it in a future book. In fact, my next book, In the Giants, I'm going to talk about that, because it's kind of one of the core concepts of the Giants, is being these shades that they're constantly being reborn from beings who died in the world before the flood. They're trying to come back and re-inhabit these bodies of these newborn giants that were specifically designed to be for them to incarnate into. That's another subject.
So if you don't mind sharing with people, what is the what do you think the name of your next book is going to be?
I don't want to give the name yet, because I don't want people to copycat, but it's nearly done now. I've been sitting there for a while, I understand, and I apologize. But I've come to the point where I can actually finish it up now. I'll probably have it out by next summer. And so just in time for the tribulation to start. So get your seatbelts fastened. Yes, get your seatbelts fastened, and you have all the information at your fingertips. You know, why is this all happening? Blah, blah, blah. Honestly, my honest answer to that is, you know, why I sent it out, is because I was moving so fast that God put the brakes on me. I was unleashing too much too quickly. I was getting too deep, too far, to the point where I might release information that could actually cause a problem. And so I was basically, the brakes were put on, and I was told to stop for years.
Oh, wow.
And I'm only just now getting back to the point where I'm able to finish it. Not only in terms of time, but also emotionally and energy. I just had no energy. I was so busy with work and other stuff and promoting Planet X and all the rest, having a life, that the amount of energy required, which is a substantial amount, because the dragon's a very powerful adversary, and he's very, very against me writing this book, because it contains his major secrets. This will come out only when God wants it to come out, and not before. So I apologize, but what God wants, God gets. It's his book. I'm just writing it. I mean, you know, it's a cliche, but it's true. So it'll come out when it comes out. When it needs to come out, we can be satisfied with that.
Now, some people out there, Bob Fletcher is one of them. You've probably heard of him. Other folks as well believe that, and there's probably some truth to it. I would expect that part of the, you know, I don't know, for lack of a better term, forces of darkness agenda to topple down, you know, a wide variety, if not the vast majority, of the developed countries and put them under a control grid, e.g. martial law, a big part of that is to have that control in place before this, you know, Planet X Nibiru manifestation becomes painfully obvious, whereby there would be, you know, mass global hysteria as a result of it. Do you see a connection between between the whole martial law concept and the visible, you know, hey, whoa, there it is, kind of Planet X thing?
Yeah, well, they're building up for the final conflict. It's the forces of the dragon arraying themselves in a final last stand against the forces of Christ. In my opinion, there's been an ongoing battle for thousands, I don't know, maybe millions of years, in which the forces of Satan, which once rung amok in the universe, who have been cornered finally in this part of this solar system. I suspect the only areas of the universe that they still control to any extent, probably only from the asteroid belt on inwards to the sun. I'm not sure if they truly control it, they just have a strong influence. But I do think that the final battle involved them, in fact, it'll be the last century, has been involved with the cleaning up of the inner solar system. That's why we have all these aliens crashed into the Earth and Roswell, all this stuff, because they're being defeated and thrown down to Earth, cornered and captured and limited to Earth specifically, where they're going to make their last stand.
Do you believe? I mean, I'm going to admit, I do believe that this is true, but I'm not going to corner you to agree with me because it's very controversial. But do you believe the wars in the heavens are literal?
Yeah, there's literal physical objects, craft being used to attack each other.
Yeah,
there's a spiritual,
I agree too.
Naturally, but
You
have to, in order to move physical objects, you have to have physical forces. I mean,
yeah, so
unless
even
there's
if
some
you're
way
a
from
spiritual
spirits
being
to move, so.
So what you're saying is, and correct me if I'm wrong, keep me sane, keep me honest, but you believe that even though you might be a spiritual being, in order to interact in a war capacity with these fallen beings, you may have to, you know, leverage similar technologies to affect a war against them as a spiritual being, perhaps.
I do think that. And, for example, the mark of a craft that shows up in Ezekiel might actually be an actual physical craft. What we call a spacecraft that is used to travel between various points in the heavens, perhaps to planet X and back, who can watch, can speculate. And that there's at least seven of these currently patrolling the Earth, what I'm calling battle carriers.